Hello friends, welcome to GYS. How are you? I hope you are doing well. So friends, as you know that on our channel, we are covering the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services, and for that purpose, we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So currently we have 10 series that focus on your prelims and one series that target your mains. So what we do in these prelims oriented series, we daily cover 10 to 15 questions of one topic, and in this manner we cover daily two topics, and you can calculate that if 10 to 15 questions of one topic are covered, then approximately total 20 to 30 questions are daily covered here on our channel relating to your prelims of 2019. So friends, we will continue to do so till 31st May. So in this manner we have identified 10 topics which are covered in cyclic manner. For example, two topics are covered today, two topics are covered tomorrow, and two topics are covered day after tomorrow. And in this manner, in 5 days, 10 topics are covered, and this cycle goes on and on. And this will be continued till 31st May. So why the date chosen has been 31st May? Because on 2nd June is your prelims of UPSC CSE 2019. So today in this lecture, we will be covering about the science and technology. So this is lecture number 4 of science and technology. So let's see what are the questions of today. The first question is related to Barak 8 missile, and we have to choose which of the following is incorrect. A, it has been developed jointly by India and Russia. B, it is a long-range nuclear capable ballistic missile. C, it is capable to neutralize aerial targets. D, none of the above. So let me tell you friends that A statement is incorrect, because it is not jointly developed by India and Russia. Actually, it is jointly developed by India and Israel. So this is Barak 8 missile is a long-range nuclear capable ballistic missile. So it's more its importance lies in its capability to neutralize aerial targets, for example missiles or rockets that could be targeting the ground facilities of the military establishment. So this is the main advantage of this Barak 8 missile, but it neutralizes the aerial targets. So the solution is A, because it is wrong. It is not developed jointly by India and Russia, but developed jointly by India and Israel. So this is about your first question. So here is the explanation. So as I have told you, it is a long-range nuclear capable ballistic missile developed jointly by Israel and India, and it has capacity to identify and neutralize various forms of aerial threats such as rockets, UAVs, planes, helicopters in a single flight. So it is technologically advanced in this aspect. So let's move on to the second question. The second question is, the major international protocols that address genetically modified organisms are: first, Cartagena Protocol; second, Nagoya Kuala Lumpur Supplementary Protocol; third, Helsinki Convention; fourth, Geneva Protocol. So friends, we have to choose the correct answers. Let me tell you friends, we have to choose the correct protocols which are related to genetically modified organisms. So let me tell you friends that yes, 1 and 2 are related to these GMOs, because this Cartagena Protocol, this is basically associated with your Convention on Biosafety. It is also referred to as Convention on Biosafety. So it was a kind of a supplementary or complementary protocol that was adopted to the Convention on Biodiversity that was signed in 1992 in Rio de Janeiro, which is also called as Earth Summit. So after Earth Summit, Cartagena Protocol was adopted, and this protocol was basically, it focused upon your careful handling and kind of transfer and managing of genetically modified organisms. And after long discussions among the member nations, one more protocol was adopted, that is Nagoya Protocol, which was a kind of a supplementary protocol to Cartagena Protocol. So it was basically to fix the liability of the countries who developed genetically modified organisms if these genetically modified organisms caused some harm in the other nation. So in that case, the liability will be on the country that is genetically modifying these organisms. So that is basically the Nagoya Protocol. So both these protocols are associated with genetically modified organisms. So the answer is 1 and 2 only. So A is the answer. So solution is A. So let me tell you friends that this Helsinki Convention is not related to this. Helsinki Convention is related to marine protection of marine life, and Geneva Protocol is associated with prevention of use of bio biochemical materials for the warfare purposes. So third and fourth is not in it. So answer is A, 1 and 2 only. So as I have told you that this United Nations Convention on Biological Diversity, also known as Earth Summit or Rio de Janeiro Summit, that is Cartagena, it was signed in 1992. And after that came your Cartagena Protocol on Biosafety, and after that comes your Nagoya Protocol. So this is about your question. So let me tell you, friends, that this Helsinki protocol is associated with protection of marine environment of the Baltic Sea area, and Geneva protocol basically addresses the prohibition of use in war of asphyxiating, poisonous or other gases of bacteriological methods of warfare. So it basically regulates your this chemical or biological warfare for that matter. So let's move on to the third question. The third question is, what do you understand by the dual nature of the light? So here we have been asked that what do we understand by the dual nature of light? A, light is both a wave and a particle. B, light always travels in a straight line. C, light travels without being refracted through a transparent medium. D, light can exhibit wavelengths from both ends of the electromagnetic spectrum. So let me tell you, friends, that the correct answer is A, that is, light is both a wave and a particle. So friends, this is basically the dual nature of light. It also acts as a particle and also acts as a wave. So when it travels in a straight line, it acts as a kind of particle, and when it reflects itself or in around the objects, then it acts like a wave. So the answer is A. So here is the explanation about it. Solution is A. So light has dual nature. Sometimes it behaves like a particle called a photon, which explains how light travels in straight lines, and sometimes it behaves like wave, which explains how light bends or diffracts around an object. So together Max Planck and Albert Einstein explained this photoelectric effect by assuming that light was actually a stream of little particles called quanta or photons. So also, but now scientists believe that light has both the wave nature as well as particle nature. So let's move on to the fourth question. Fourth question is, searchlights and vehicle headlights get powerful parallel beams of light by using A, convex mirrors, B, polar mirrors, C, bifocal mirrors, and D, concave mirrors. So here we have been asked that which of the following mirrors are used in searchlights and vehicle headlights. So let me tell you, friends, that the concave mirrors are used because they produce the parallel beams of light, and convex mirrors are not used. In actual practice, concave mirrors are used, and concave mirrors are also used in case of by dentists, and also these headlights as well as searchlights. So the answer is D, concave mirrors. So it is concave mirror is usually used in torches, searchlights and vehicle headlights, and also as shaving mirrors and and also by dentists to see large images of teeth of patients, and also to concentrate sunlight to produce heat in solar furnaces. Let's move on to the fifth question. The fifth question is, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change is the leading international body for the assessment of climate change. Consider the following statements about it. So friends, you might know this fact, that this IPCC is the leading international body for the assessment of climate change, and we have to consider certain statements about it. First, its membership is open to all member countries of the United Nations. Second, it was established by the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. And third is, scientists from all over the world contribute to the work of the IPCC on a voluntary basis without receiving pecuniary incentives. Fourth, it publishes assessment reports on an annual basis addressing climate change related issues. So we have to choose the correct statement. Let me tell you, friends, that this Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, this is a leading body and that deals with the climate change. And yes, it is open to all members of United Nations as well as World Meteorological Organization. So first statement is correct. But let me tell you, friends, that the second statement is incorrect. It is not established under United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. It was actually established under United Nations Environment Program and by the World Meteorological Organization in 1988. So, and also, friends, this third statement is correct. Yes, scientists contribute from all over the world to the work of IPCC on a voluntary basis. There is no kind of any benefit given to any scientist for its work on for his or her work for IPCC. So let me tell you, friends, that yes, IPCC works assessment reports, but let me clarify Sci-Fi here, these are not published on annual basis. They are published randomly without any kind of thinking about, on annual basis or other things. So friends, the first and third only statement is correct, that is 1 and 3. So the answer would be A, that is 1 and 3 only. So here is the justification, as I have told you, that this is IPCC is a body that is open to all the member countries of United Nations under WMO, and it was established in under by the United Nations Environment Programme and World Meteorological Organization in 1988. So this IPCC is a huge yet very small organization, and the scientists work in it on a voluntary basis. So let me tell you friends, the first report was published in 1990. Please keep note of this. This is important. First report was published in 1990, and then in 1995, and then in 2001, and then in 2007, and fifth recently in 2013 and 14. So this is about your fifth question. Let's move on to the sixth question. Sixth question is, the sun is visible to us about 2 minutes before actual sunrise and about 2 minutes after the actual sunset because of. So here we have been asked that why we are able to see the sun before its actual sunrise and before and after its actual sunset. So let me tell you friends that this is basically due to. So first you have to tell that basically it is due to which of the following: dispersion of sunlight, B, total internal refraction of sunlight, C, atmospheric refraction, D, constructive interference of sunlight. Let me tell you friends that the answer is C, that is atmospheric refraction. In actual practice, this atmospheric refraction, this changes the apparent position of sun, and we are able to see the sun 2 minutes before its sunrise and 2 minutes after the sunset. And the solution is, in this case, is C. So here you can see that by actual sunrise we mean when the actual crossing of the horizon by the sun takes place. So here is the diagram that I have included. So you can see it here. Here is Earth, and this is Earth's atmosphere that is surrounding the Earth. So if you can see this sun, for example, this is horizon. So this sun is below the horizon, but we are able to see the sun in the sky. Why it is so? Because when the light enters the Earth's atmosphere, then it undergoes refraction due to different layers in atmosphere, which cause the refraction. So this refraction leads to kind of your visibility of the sun, and it appears that sunlight comes from the sky. In actual practice, it is coming from below the horizon, but sun is visible to us in the sky. So the answer is that is C. It is due to refraction of light. So apparent position of the sun is here. In actual practice, it is here. So this actually makes the day 4 minutes longer. 2 minutes in the morning, 2 minutes in the evening. Let's move on to the seventh question. The seventh question is, these bacteria are the most common cause of travelers' diarrhea, as transmission usually occurs through contaminated food and water. Some of its serotypes and are harmless and cause gastroenteritis in humans. It is A, Salmonella typhi, B, E. coli, C, Shigella, and D is Listeria monocytogenes. So let me tell you friends that the answer is B, that is E. coli. So this is these are a type of bacteria that cause diarrhea and also cholera. So the solution is B. So they are also responsible. Some strains of these are also responsible for the pneumonia. But its strains are beneficial. They reside in our gut and can benefit the host by producing vitamin K2 and preventing the colonization by the other pathogenic bacteria. But sometimes they are kind of some strains of it are harmful to human beings that cause in human beings cholera and diarrhea. So they enter the food chain or water through fecal matter. So this if there is large presence of E. coli in river waters, then it is an indicator of the large dumping of fecal matter in that river. Let's move on to the eighth question. The eighth question is, nettle leaves have stinging hair which cause painful stings when touched accidentally. Despite giving pain, stinging nettles is useful as A, analgesic, B, antioxidant, C, antimicrobial agent, D, all of the above. So let me tell you friends that this nettle leaves, they have kind of various type of chemicals in them, and when we accidentally touch them, they cause pain And yes, friends, they are very, 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 very kind of. They have very variety of medicinal properties, and they can act as also as analgesic and antioxidant and antimicrobial agent. So all of the above are the properties of nettle leaves. So the solution is D. So here is the explanation. So here you can see this nettle leaves. I have included this pic image of nettle leaves. So let's move on to the ninth question. The ninth question is: bulbs are usually filled with chemically inactive nitrogen and argon gases to two. First, prolong the life of filament. Second, cut down the current voltage conversion significantly in the bulb. So which of the above is correct? So let me tell you, friends, that yes, this argon and nitrogen, what it does, it prolongs the life of the filament. So filament basically is kind of a material that is present in the bulb, which is heated to extreme temperatures, and due to extreme, it is heated by passing of electric current through it, and when it becomes extremely hot, it starts glowing, and when it glows, it passes the light, and thus bulb glows and produces light. And for this purpose, as lot of heat is conserved in the filament, so the filament the element or the matter thing used in for the filament, that must have high kind of melting point, otherwise it would melt easily. So mostly tungsten is used as filament. So nowadays these bulbs are on decline, but earlier they were used. So filament was basically tungsten, and the bulb was used to fill with the gases like nitrogen and argon to prolong the life of the filament. So the answer is A, one only. So the solution is A. So electric heating is also used to produce light in an electric bulb. So this is a strong metal with high melting points, such as tungsten, is used for making bulb filaments. So this is about your ninth question. So basically it is thermally isolated as much as possible using insulating support. So chemically inactive nitrogen and argon, they are kind of provide insulating support, and thus they prolong the life of filament. Tenth is, consider the following statements. A, continuous passage of electric current in a circuit produces heat. Reason, electrons are consumed in an electric current. So friends, let me tell you, friends, that your assertion is certainly true, as I have explained in previous question, that this continuous passage of electric current through a circuit produces heat. In actual practice, this electric bulb is also a type of electric circuit in which filament is heated to such an extent that it starts glowing. But let me tell you, friends, that this passes, yes, it certainly produces heat, but let me tell you that electrons are not consumed in an electric circuit. Electrons are not a kind of thing that will be and they will kind of they will be consumed. Electrons are never consumed, they remain there in presence. So reason is clearly incorrect. So A is correct, but R is incorrect. So the answer would be C. That is, A is correct, but R is incorrect. So the solution is C. And the many people think that the electrons are consumed in an electric circuit, but this is wrong. We pay the electricity board or electric company to provide energy to move electrons through the electric gadgets like electric bulb, fan and engine. So this is all about, friends, today's lecture. If you like the lecture, if you like the questions, please do like our video and do share it with your friends. And if you, friends, want to subscribe to the PDFs of these MCQs, then you can contact us at this email ID, that is achieveies21@gmail.com. or at this contact number, that is 8968426481. So this is our contact number and this is our email ID. You can contact on this email ID or you can contact us on this number. So let me tell you, friends, that as we are putting in a lot of effort, so certainly the PDF of these explanation videos is chargeable. It is, we have kept the cost as minimum as possible so that you people can afford it. But let me tell you, friends, that why these PDFs are important, because at the end of the day you will not be able to see 25 to 30 minute long video for revision purposes, or for that matter you will not be able to revise your concepts through standard books, or for that matter NCERTs, because at that time you will have to revise multiple topics at a time. So that would be an utter wastage of time if you relied on the videos, or for that matter on the standard books, or for that matter on NCERTs. So at that time you must have some kind of notes or some kind of PDFs from which you can revise quickly. So these PDFs are designed in a method, so obviously as you have seen in the lecture, that we also provided the explanation of each question. So these these questions also help in clearing your concepts as well as continuous revision by the explanation. So through explanation, you are able to revise your continuous topics without going there to read the standard books. So this helps you in revision multiple times, and in this way you can better your chances for clearing prelims. So in case you want to subscribe to these PDFs, you can contact us at this email ID or for that matter at this number which is on which WhatsApp is available. So thank you, friends. Have a nice day. Thank you very much.